Shalom, greetings from Covenant Calendar Club. We're so glad that you're here, and we pray that you'll be richly blessed by the word of Yahuwah as it comes out of the mouth of our teachers. I'm going to start off by just giving you a warm welcome and a shout out and say, shall we, everyone?
Shalom, everyone. Shalom.
Shalom. Hi, everyone.
Shabbat shalom on the high Sabbath.
Sabbath. Yeah, there we go. Shabbat shalom on the high Sabbath. Okay.
Shabbat shalom, everyone.
Shabbat shalom. If you'd like to get involved with Covenant Calendar Club and after the teachings and feast days and things like that, feel free to go to studyofthecalendar.com where you can get more information and join us from there. And with that said, we're going to go ahead and give the screen over to whoever takes it.
Thank you, Mario. It's nice to see you here with us tonight. Really appreciate that. And should I go ahead with a little introduction, Tim? Are you ready for that?
Get right at her.
Okay. Well, we just want to welcome everybody. It's really nice to see we have some new faces tonight at Covenant Calendar Club. And I think that's because we had Passover yesterday and we had some meetings today. So we just love to have our new people joining us. It's always fun. And I think you've all been welcomed. But for the brand new people that maybe haven't been following, we have some. Somebody's in charge of the. I don't think I can do it. Anyway, for our brand new people tonight, maybe our little event that we're doing might be over your head, but maybe it won't. And so, just to let you know, we changed our plans. We were going to do part two of the Covenant Calendar Journey, and we changed our plans. Another calendar came across our desk this last week, I think just since last week, Friday, and we want to take a look at it because it's quite different than Covenant Calendar. And Tim and I aren't really going to be doing any teaching tonight. Tim will bring up the PowerPoint slides. They're in a PDF. And we want you as the panel members to go through this and just see if you can tell us or each other what the problems are. We've looked at a lot on the book of Joshua and his wave sheath, and of course the sickle. We've done six huge lessons that Joshua shows how you can detect a counterfeit calendar, like just so simply. We've done a lot of work in Joshua. There are other studies as well. But this is an interesting calendar, and I'm sure there's going to be others similar to it. So Tim, would you just share your screen? And I don't know if I can keep track of the hands that go up. I don't know. Am I co-host, Tim, so I can watch hands? Or
I am co-host, and I'll have.
Oh, you are co-host. Okay.
Yeah, and I will try and keep track of that. Notice I said try.
Yeah, it's pretty hard to watch everything, but
I can't see the hands now.
Open
no, I
prayer.
Didn't think you could not. Oh, yes, we should do that. Thank you. Damon, why don't you go right ahead since you've got your mic open? Why don't you just go ahead?
Are you sure? Because I was going to elect Eric Berry.
How about I go first?
I'll go first right now, then Eric, you close. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the Feast of Unleavened Bread and your love and your emancipation towards us. Thank you so much for this body of believers that are here. And I pray, Heavenly Father, through the Ruach, that you would give us laser vision to decode the evil of this calendar. And I thank you so very much for you being here with us. Amen.
Thank you. Now, there are 72 slides, and I really don't think we'll get through all of them. But we'll just do what we can, right, Tim? And
yes.
We'll let the panel decide you know, because we have a little bit of time and we're not pressed for, you know, for any other engagement that I know of. But why don't we just get started? And Tim, you might want to do a little bit of reading, and we'll just kind of leave it open for people to comment, right?
Okay, and I can't see any hands so on my screen because of the format here, so we're just going to have to go with it. Let's start out here. This calendar that come to us is, just lately. The time of the end, knowing when it's time. Part two, the true count to the Feast of Weeks and why it matters. Everybody can see what's on the screen, can they? Is it up?
Yes, Tim, it's
okay.
Good
stuff. Aspects to the count from multiple witnesses, Leviticus 23, 15 to 16, and Deuteronomy 16, 9 to 10. Witnesses in astronomy and the Exodus chronology account. The Exodus chronology account. I think this is going to be very interesting, to say the least. And we're going to be looking at the prophetic shadow pictures in type and in time. Next slide here. Instructions in Leviticus and Deuteronomy. Leviticus 23, 15 to 16. And you shall remember, and you shall number, H 5608, to you from the next day after the Sabbath, from the day you bring in the sheaf of the wave offering, they shall be seven complete Sabbaths. The next day after the seventh Sabbath, you shall number 5608, 50 days, and you shall bring near and new food offering to Yahuwah. This is a different version of the scriptures, very different. LITV, I'm not really familiar with that one. Deuteronomy 16, 9 to 10, in the LXX, Tuagint. Seven entire periods of seven you shall count out to yourself with the beginning of your sickle upon the harvest. You shall begin to count out seven periods of seven. And you shall observe the holiday of the period of sevens to Yahuwah, your mighty one. Why are there two separate counts of seven weekly periods in the same passage? What does that look like charted out? So we're going to come to some very interesting questions here. It says, why are there two separate counts of seven weekly periods in the same passage? Now, I'm really thankful that the people on this panel have been paying very close attention to the studies that we have just done with Joshua, because I think there's going to be some interesting answers to this question that was posed. Intro, the Creator's monthly format. The very first sentence on this chart I want you to look at very closely. Every month looks like this. Every month looks like this. So I'm going to be asking the people on the panel here today, what does this month look like to you? And I'm going to read Ezekiel and Amos, and then I'm going to be open for some comments. Ezekiel 46:1. The gate of the inner court that faces the east shall be shut 6 days of work, but on the Sabbath day it shall be opened, and in the day of the new moon it shall be opened. Amos 8:5, saying, when will the new moon have passed so that we may buy grain, or the Sabbath so that we may open the wheat, making smaller the ephah and making greater the shekel, and to falsify the deceitful balances? And the comment, buying and selling is prohibited on Sabbaths and new moon days. And I'm hoping that somebody can come up with a scripture that tells me that buying and selling is prohibited on new moon days. I would find that very interesting. But maybe I'm jumping ahead of myself. Maybe I should let other people talk. Is there somebody else? Go ahead, Charlene.
Yeah, I would like to ask some questions. Feel free to open your mics here, and we'll all take turns. Does anybody see some problems or some advantages of what you haven't seen for Covenant Calendar before? Is there anything here that jumps out at you right now on this particular screen? Are there any Torah verses? That's my one question. Are there any Torah verses?
Does this thing imply a floating data? Like, it changes all the time?
No, it seems to be that each month replicates itself. However, the fault is the seventh day is no longer the Sabbath on this calendar. The seventh day is the sixth day according to this calendar.
It's also strange because if you look at the first of the month on the Sabbath up there, which is what they're saying is the new moon day, but then the 30th, you know, is on the first day of a week. If the 30th is on the first day of the week, then how can the first day of the month be on the last day of the week? Just that right there.
That would leave floating days every month.
Yes, it's a moon calendar, so a lot of the months only have 29 days. And they are sticking to 8/15, 22, 29 for Sabbath 12 months a year, and it isn't right.
It makes no sense, really.
So why would the 8/15, 22, and 29 not be right? What is it? What makes you say that they are not correct?
Because even if you follow a moon calendar, some months you're going to have 30 days, and therefore you need to change the date of the Sabbath.
Wow.
But what if the first of the month and the 30th of these months are not accountable? And what if the 8th, the 15th, and the 22nd, and the 29th are in fact Sabbaths on this calendar? Is that a problem, or is it correct with the scriptures?
Not accountable. That would be a big if.
Well, it's incorrect with the scriptures, because the scriptures is 30 day months period.
Yeah,
you can't even count 29 if one isn't counted.
So, I mean, this transition, is this saying that there's an extra week after every month that just disappears?
I don't know.
No, they just revert back to one.
Yes.
Right, but wouldn't that put the first day on the second day of the week?
No, because the first day they have up there is not counted, and that's either the sliver or the conjunction, the way they do it.
Now, are you telling me that first and the 30th days are not counted in the calendar?
Well, they're counted, but they're not counted as a day of the week.
Okay.
That's the only way you can read it.
Yeah, I see what you're saying. Jose, you have your hand up, and I don't know if I can't tell by your voice if you've been talking. So why don't you open up your mic and talk to us?
No, I was going to, and I just realized that my mute button was on. So there, I think they're elevating the dates as opposed to the seventh day. So they're elevating, they're putting more precedence, more importance on the date of each month as opposed to the seventh day of the week. So they're not treating them independently, the seventh day Shabbat, from the dates. So they're like, you know, that's the way I see it. They're putting more, you know, like I said, they're elevating their dates as opposed to the seventh day of the
To build on what you're saying, Jose, it's the date, but it's more the moon phase. So there's four phases of the moon, so it's 8, 15, 22, 29 to line up with the moon phase every month.
Mm-hmm. And it's irregular. It's variable every month. So if this is based on a moon, I mean, if we're talking about the moon here, it's going to be variable every week, but looks like they have a static days of the week that they consider Shabbat. All, you know, so regardless of if they fall on different, whether it's a Wednesday, Tuesday, Friday, I'm just, the way I see it is that the 8th, 15th, 22nd, 29th are always the Shabbats.
Yes.
Right. So, yeah, so that means that their Shabbats could fall, you know, any day of the week, basically. As long as it says the 8th, 15th, 22nd, 29th.
But see, they're resetting their week every month.
Mm-hmm. So I'm going to ask a question. I'm going to want to point a little bit to scriptures here. The 22nd, it's claimed that is a Sabbath. Am I correct on this reading this calendar? The 22nd is a Sabbath?
Yep.
So let's look at Numbers 10. I want people to read Numbers 10, verse 11. If somebody can read that for me, I would appreciate it. Numbers 10, verse 11.
10, 11?
Yes.
And it came to pass on the 20th day of the second month in the second year that the cloud was taken up off from the tabernacle of the testimony.
What date was that?
The 20th?
20th day of the second month in the second year.
Okay, let's go to verse 33. Verse 33. I would like someone to read verse 33 for me, please.
From the mountain of, okay, from the mountain of Yahuwah, they made a journey of 3 days, and the Ark of the Covenant of Yahuwah went before them for 3 day journey to seek out a resting place for them.
What day did they leave?
20th.
Okay. But no, so if they did leave on the 20th and they traveled 3 days, would they be traveling on the 22nd, the seventh day Sabbath?
No.
Because if they left on the 20th, 20, 21, and 22, that would be a day of travel on the 22nd. But what if they didn't leave on the 20th, but that the cloud had lifted on the 20th, and the following day, which would be the 21st, what would happen if they left on that day and they traveled for 3 days? Would they not be still traveling on this 22nd on the Sabbath?
They will be breaking the covenant.
Do we have a problem with this, or is that acceptable?
Wait till you get into the Omer count.
You know, it's interesting because I just finished a PowerPoint exactly on this verse, and we are going to be delivering this in some time to come. But let's continue on here. Is there other scriptures that will have a problem with the 8th, the 15th, the 22nd, and the 29th being Sabbaths?
Does anybody remember when Joshua declared a Sabbath in the first month? What day was that?
On a Shabbat. Oh, no. What I'm sorry.
It was on Sunday. Was it Wave Sheaf? Yeah. It was on Sunday, right?
Yeah.
So what day was the seventh day Sabbath? Date and day was the seventh day Sabbath?
On the 14th.
On
the 14th, right?
Yes, the 14th was on a seventh day Sabbath when Joshua entered Canaan.
That's right, yeah.
So shall we just fudge it in and just say, well, okay, maybe that was an exception according to this calendar. What do we do with that controversy?
throw this calendar in the trash?
Come on, Johnny. I wouldn't be quite that graphic. You know, I just want to point these a few things out. We need to go back to the scriptures, and we need to do our due diligence. Because when you go through Joshua's study, the seventh day Sabbath was on a 14th of a month. So when it says here that every month looks like this, that means it is not scriptural. Right there. Just my thoughts. What do you think, Charlene?
Well, I have another question, and we're not hearing a lot from our other calendar people, but if the 15th is indeed a Sabbath every single month, especially in the first month, where does that put the wave sheaf, and what kind of a problem does that cause? Because the 15th is also going to be their unleavened bread Sabbath. I don't know if we've gotten to that point yet, but that is also an unleavened bread Sabbath, including, they call it like a high Sabbath. It's unleavened bread and a weekly Sabbath. So where is wave sheaf every single Passover festival?
Fits right in with the 16th.
Mary? Yeah.
Mary?
Yeah, on that.
Is that a problem? There's no other way.
Bible, does it say that the Sabbaths fall on the 8th, the 15th, the 22nd, and the 29th?
What was the question again?
Tell them that.
It's going to throw the wave sheaf into another week, and if you go to the next slide, I think it exposes that. It throws the wave sheaf into a different, completely different count.
Okay, so, well, that's not quite ready to go to the next slide yet. I want to take us through that, to that verse in Ezekiel 46:1, the bottom, the last phrase of it. And in the day of the new moon, it shall be opened. I was wondering if somebody could verify me that that verse actually has moon written in it. And we might as well do the same for Amos 8:5. Is the word for the moon, the Hebrew word, is it in those verses?
No, it's the word Chodesh.
Well, doesn't that mean moon?
Well, no, that means month.
I mean, well,
the word moon is Yerach.
But when I look up in the Strong's, it relates and it says in italics the moon.
Of course,
it says in italics moon, because they want to imply that it means moon, when in reality moon has its own word, which is Yerach, which is kind of ironically enough the verse I'm looking at right now, where they were marching around Yericho for the 7 days and destroying the 13th cycle of their false year.
So
destroying the city.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So Jesse, are you telling me that the word or words new moon should not be written in Ezekiel 46:1?
In my
new month.
In my Bible it says moon.
It says new moon?
It says, thus says Adonai Yahuwah, the gate of the inner court that looks toward the east shall be shut the 6 working days, but on the Sabbath it shall be open. And in the day of the new moon it shall be open.
Yeah. Yes, it most definitely. In fact, my scripture has new moon there too, or one of my scriptures has new moon.
The scriptures from the ISR also says new moon. But so, funny enough, when you cross-reference that same exact verse with the KJV, it doesn't say moon, it says month.
Oh.
And then you research the word that they use for month just to verify that, you know, it should say moon. It's actually the Hebrew word for moon, chodesh.
The word for moon is Kodesh?
Yes. Month.
Oh, for month. Okay.
Yes. For month. Yeah. Kodesh is month.
Yeah, that's month. Moon is Yerach.
So the word Kodesh, what does it actually mean?
Moon? I'm sorry, month.
No, not quite. What is, it's a verb.
It's a repetitive occurrence.
Okay.
Hebrew number 3391, a repetitive occurrence.
Renew.
Could it be the...
Renewed.
Yes. Renewed, there you go.
The renewing and or the rebuilding. So when the word Chodesh is applied to time, it means a new month. But there is no connection for that word Chodesh to moon. There's no connection in any way, shape, or form. That is an implied thought. And Jesse, you mentioned that when I mentioned about italics. What is it about italics when we see that? Why are things written in italics?
Because it was
added. A translator's opinion.
Yeah, they put their own opinion in it.
So can we say that something written in italics might not be factual?
Yes.
Definitely.
Okay. It's a word that's not found on the actual original text.
Yes, yes. So what you're telling me is that this new moon in Ezekiel 46 might not be new moon. Is that correct?
Correct.
That's correct.
Now, in Ezekiel, I believe it's, I can't remember, Ezekiel spoke of a Shane year. I think it was around 12 times he mentioned a Shane year. So the question I have is, could a Shane year have a lunar month in it?
No.
Why not?
Because the Shane year is it refers to the circuit of the sun. It refers to the revolution of the sun by definition. And the moon cannot make up 360 days based on its circular month. I mean, it's because it's irregular. It's 29 days. So it cannot make 360 days to make it a full Shane year. The moon would take more than 12 months for it to reach 360 days.
That's pretty simple. We just add a 13th month.
Yes. No, we don't do that.
Yes. No. Okay. Let me get this straight. Yes. No. Jesse, are you there? Jesse?
Yes, I'm here.
What happened to the 13th month at Jericho? Can you explain? Fell
down just like the walls.
It fell down. What, can you explain it to us, Jesse?
According to the verses that I'm looking at here,
I guess a question I can ask you, how many times did they march around Jericho?
Once every day for 6 days, and then seven times on the seventh day.
How much does 7 + 6 equal?
13.
13, I know Vivian's voice. So on the 13th time around Jericho, what happened?
The walls collapsed, the foundations crumbled.
I love it. The foundation of what?
The foundation of their belief.
Yes. Jericho was the center of moon worship at that time. That is why Yahuwah destroyed it. It was the first thing that Yahuwah did when Joshua came into Canaan. Why? Because it was the center of moon worship. So on the 13th march around, and on the blast of the shofar, the foundation of moon worship didn't just fall over. It sunk into the ground because the Hebrew warriors went over these walls without obstruction. There was nothing there for them to climb over. These walls went into the ground. What about Revelation 12, verse 1, and Bethula standing on the moon? Can somebody tell me about that?
Yes, bride has the moon under her feet.
Yes.
Meaning that we don't worship the moon whatsoever.
So who is Bethula in Revelation 12:1? Who is Bethula?
That's the virgin.
Yeah. The bride of Yahusha at the end of time. And what are they doing with the moon?
Trampling over her feet.
Good answer. Good answer. So at the end of time, the system of worshiping by the moon will have authority or no authority?
No authority.
No authority.
Okay, very good. Excellent. Shall we move on to the next slide?
I just have a point. A question just came through to my email about 2 days ago with the Jericho thing that said this from someone that uses the moon in their calendar. Yes, the pagans did worship the moon, and Yahuwah did destroy Jericho because they were worshiping the moon. But Yah's people were not worshiping the moon because the moon is part of the timepiece of his festival clock. So when they're using the moon for their month, that is not considered as worshiping the moon, because it's part of the timepiece. That was the comment that came through to me just 2 days ago.
Okay. Yeah. So what is your question on that, Charlene?
Well, how do you answer that? The pagans were worshiping the moon, and yes, they had to be destroyed and cleaned out of the land. But when Yahuwah's people were using the moon as a timepiece, that is not the same.
If you're giving it sacred regard, that is worship.
Well, they specifically made a point that that was not worship. They specifically said, I know what serve and worship means, and that basically for us to say that using the moon as part of the timepiece to mark out the worship cycles of the festivals, that was not the same.
He said not to look to the sun and the moon for keeping time to count. So the disobedience is the being led astray and worshiping something else, because you're not worshiping him if you're not obeying him.
Very good.
Yeah, well, I'd already covered all of that.
Yeah. The moon has low batteries. It can't keep up with the year.
I got my hand up, but you might not be able to see my hand. What sticks out to me when it comes to the timepiece is Genesis 1:14, when it talks about the lights. It mentions days and years, but the word month is not there. So that leads me to believe that the lights are not used to start the month, but if they're used for starting days and years. So I don't think the month is a part of the timepiece. I mean, or the moon is a part of the timepiece for starting months anyway.
And Brenda from Florida, you have your hand up. Brenda, would you like to talk to us, please?
Okay, I just talked because I didn't think you guys could see hands since you weren't calling people by hands. But I just said what I wanted to say. I said Genesis 1:14, when it mentions the light, it mentions for days and years, but not months.
Okay, not months. So what
Ron's got his hand up too there, Tim, if you can see it. Ron.
I can't see that one. Go ahead, Ron.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Can you hear me? First, if you look at the PDF, what we're all looking for right now, what is one thing that we don't see in here at all?
Can you speak a little closer to your microphone? There's a bad echo. I'm having trouble.
What is when we look at this part of the PDF? What's one thing that we notice that's not mentioned anywhere in here?
Okay, let us know. Inform us.
I'm sorry. Nothing is based out of Torah.
Right.
And nothing is based out of Torah. Everything that Charlene, when I jumped on board and she started helping Marlise and I, she drilled it in my head. You've got to have everything as a witness based in Torah, and it works off of that. You can't, this doesn't work like that. It just doesn't work like that.
Thank you, Charlene.
Yeah, it just doesn't work like that, but yeah.
Jesse, you have your hand up. Can you talk to us, Jesse?
Yeah, I just wanted to, reiterate that the very first place that the Israelites attacked was Jericho. And the definition for that city, the name of that city, is its moon. Its moon. He is attacking its moon first and foremost coming into the land. So we're supposed to go against that and start using the moon all over again for some sort of guidance when the first thing he destroyed was the moon. I don't understand it.
He destroyed the worship of the moon. Yeah.
And he put the children of Israel smack dab amongst the Amalekites who were worshiping Allah, the moon worshiping God.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean the definitions that I have here, the word Yericho comes from H3394 Yareach, and that is moon. Point blank, moon. Yareach.
That's right.
Means moon.
Yeah.
I don't see Kodesh in there anywhere. I don't see anything that connects it to that word Kodesh. There is no, the other word that it comes from is H3391, which is Yareach. It doesn't sound anything like Kodesh. So I don't understand how they're getting the word moon and month confused. I don't get it, because they're nothing alike. They have nothing to do with each other. A moon has a cycle. It has a lunation. But it's not to do with the month or when the month begins. It doesn't say anything about it.
Well, Jesse, I have a very quick answer to why that they confused Chodesh with Yareach, how that those words got switched out. And if we go to Isaiah 14:13, I'll read it to you. For you have said in your heart, let me go up to the Shemayim. Let me raise my throne above the stars of El, and let me sit in the Mount of Meeting on the sides of the north. So that Mount of Meeting is Har Moedim. That is Har is the mountain, and the Meeting is the Mount of Congregation. That is your feasts. Satan has said that he is going to be in control of the feasts. So what better way to do it than insert worship of the moon? That is how the word Chodesh became confused with the moon. Okay, I see just a phone number up there, 1-707-498-6896. Mm-hmm. You have your hand up.
That's me.
Oh, it is Dana. Okay.
Yeah, I didn't want to get out of context, but following the footsteps of the Messiah and seeing the footprints on our blood-ratified covenant that he has given us through following Moses up the mount is such a wonderful thing he has given to us. And to see these calendars come up like this just shows us the war that's against the adversary and how much the adversary hates our Messiah. not necessarily the people that put this calendar together. They can repent and come into the light, which we hope they do. But this is a direct blast against Yahusha, and we're uncovering it right now. We're gonna chop Leviathan's head off tonight. Thank you.
Okay. I brought up the next slide on this calendar, and I want everybody to look at it, and I would like your comments. And I'm purposely allowing everybody to make their own comments.
How is Satan controlling the feast?
Say that again, please.
How does Satan control the days of the feast?
He controls the days of the feast. He removed the Tekufa so that we do not know what Yahuwah's start of the year is. And he inserted the worship of the moon so that people look to the moon to determine time. When they look to the moon to determine time, there is a very irregular existence of the lunations of the moon, and it offsets people to a different calendar than Yahusha's covenant calendar. It removes people from his appointed times. Now let's go through this, and I'll read to you Isaiah 1 verse 11, and this is going to go through what Yahuwah thinks of the lunar system of worship. Verse 11, of what use to me are your many slaughterings, declares Yahuwah. I have had enough burnt offerings of rams and of fat of fed beasts. I do not delight in the blood of bulls or of lambs or of goats. Okay, now verse 12. When you come to appear before me, who has required this from your hand to trample my courtyards? That is desecration. That means there is broken statutes, there is broken laws and broken commands. Who required this from your hand to trample my courtyards? Stop bringing futile offerings and incense. It is an abomination to me. New moons. That is an abomination to Yahuwah. Shabbatot, that is Sabbaths. The calling of meetings, that is Moedim. What does he think of this when this schedule is operating on the new moon or on any lunar schedule? He says in verse 13, the last half, I am unable to bear unrighteousness and assembly. His feelings in verse 14, my being hates your new moons and your appointed times. They are a trouble to me. I am weary of bearing them. And when you spread out your hands, I hide my eyes from you. That's not as bad as what's coming. Even though you make many prayers, I do not hear. Is there anything more terrifying than Yahuwah not hearing our prayers?
Where was that in the Bible?
Isaiah 1, verse 11 to 17.
Isaiah what?
Isaiah 1. Isaiah your hands, 1. And he says, continues on, he says, your hands have become filled with blood. Verse 16, wash yourselves, make yourselves clean, put away what? Put away the evil of your doings from before me. Stop doing evil. So that is Yahuwah's feelings on the lunar system of worship, and that is exactly why he destroyed it at Jericho. So Charlene, what do you have more questions on this slide that I have up right now?
Well, I just want to get people started on it. It's talking about counting the seventh Sabbath towards, we would say the Omer count, okay? And we all know pretty much when you have to start. And it appears that they're starting their their count on the day after the 15th, which is their Sabbath. They don't have the number there, but it would be the 16th. So they've actually got, well, I don't know. We don't know if that's a Sunday because their Sabbaths can be on any day of the week. But what I want you to notice about this is there is no X with a circle around it on the 30th or the first day of the month. In the first month, the 30th isn't counted. In the second month, neither is the first or the 30th. And in the third month, the first is not counted. Now, what they're going to attempt to show is that there is more to this Omer count than just 50 days, that it's going to go another count. So as we go to the next slide, I want you to notice what happens to those days that have a 30 and a number one on them. So I think we can advance it, Tim, a little bit.
Right there.
And so now they've gone into the third month, and basically they're saying, well, we have to count now. We've done our 7 weeks. 7 times 7 is 49. And you can see where it is, week number 7 in month 3. Tim, if you have your mouse there, maybe you can follow me a little bit. So they've got their 49-day count. They're on the 8th of the month, where that first X is in the third month. Now they're going to start and count the 50 days. Do you see what happens? What numbers are now, remember where those 30s and those number 1s were before? That's my question. Why do they get counted now? Why weren't they counted before? Where did the rules change? And where do you find those hermeneutics scriptures, you know, those rules for hermeneutics in the Old Testament? And I'm going to say in the Torah. Where do you find this in the Torah that you don't have to count the first and the 30th day when you start out, but when you're doing your second round of your counting to the 50th day again, now all of a sudden you're counting? So that's what I want to know.
Jesse, you have your hand up. Well,
yeah, but it wasn't about this confusion. It was about something else.
Okay. I noticed Johnny put his hand up. Johnny and Joan, what have you got for us?
Well, it was like I was saying earlier, they don't consider the 1st or the 30th as part of the week, but it's still a day. So they have to count it in the second half because it is a day if you're counting 50 days. But they don't consider it part of the week, so it's not part of the 7 Sabbaths. Which is completely unscriptural, but that's their line of reasoning.
That's a good point, Johnny. Yeah, that's a good point. So when it says 7 completed Sabbaths in the scriptures, every weekday must have a 7th day Sabbath following it that completes its purpose, because as in the manna week, every day of the week was counted in counting or in picking up manna, and the 7th day Sabbath sealed off and completed the 6 days of counting or picking manna. So this number 30 here and this number 30, do they have a 7th day Sabbath after it to complete it, to make it a viable 24-hour period? Or are these days 30? Are they rogue days? To me, they're a rogue day because they do not have a 7th day Sabbath following them to complete them. What are your thoughts?
Yeah, it's just a standalone date. I mean, it's just a standalone date. It's not completing the 7th day at all.
Who's making that noise? Yeah.
I agree. It says Rogue's a wandering moon.
Yes, it is. It's a wandering moon. And that's the moon is called the Wanderer for a reason.
Which kind of comes back to why I have my hands up. I mean, okay, we know what the lesser light mentioned in Genesis 1 is all about. But just suppose the lesser light referred to the moon, the light reflected off its surface or however you want to see it. You're telling me that as children of the day who are to follow the light, the greatest light, we should look to the moon that dwells in darkness and is considered lesser for guidance and beginning everything for us. I don't know. I'm just throwing that one out there because I know that it's not actually the lesser light that's mentioned in Genesis 1, but some people refer to it that way. In which case, if that's the case, then why would we look to it at all? It has its purpose, it has its functions, but why even consider it? See, this is why I can't have these conversations with uneducated people, because I can't overcome my understanding of this.
Yeah, excuse me just a minute. Kate, could you please mute your mic? For some reason, we're not able to mute it for you. Or Katie, okay, thank you. All right, Jesse, sorry. It was just a lot of background and we couldn't hear you.
Can you repeat it?
Oh, that's fine. You know, I don't understand it. It just, I can't. We're called to be children of the day.
Yeah.
There is no darkness nor shadow of turning in the Father. Doesn't the moon go through cycles of shadow covering?
Yes.
Okay. The light of the morning, who was that? Who was considered the light of the morning before he was cast out? I'm trying to think of what that lesser light might be known as today.
The Prince of Darkness.
That's one of the names.
Yes.
He's got many.
Where are you going with this, Jesse?
Keep going. It just goes back to the moon issue. It's the moon thing. I don't understand following something that's just not that. Just the fact that they use that to base the beginning of their months on completely invalidates the rest of this calendar. That's what I'm getting at. This calendar is flawed from its conception because of that fact.
And what about where they're trying to tell us to have a second count of 50? How does that work?
It's a twist of Enoch.
I have no idea, because when I count 7 completed weeks, that equals 50 days.
What about, let's read Leviticus 23, verse 16. Can someone read that for me, please?
The priest shall burn these on the altar as food, a sweet-smelling oblation. All of the fat belongs to Yahuwah. This shall be a perpetual ordinance for your descendants, wherever they may dwell. You shall not eat any fat or any blood. Am I reading the right Yes.
No, 23 yeah. verse 16.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought I heard you say 23. I was like, it doesn't sound like this has anything to do with what we're talking about.
No problem. No problem.
All right. So 23 verse 16. You shall count to the day after the seventh week, 50 days. Then you shall present a new grain offering to Yahuwah.
So I have something that I would like you to do. I would like you to look up in the Hebrew. Jesse, I think you have your Hebrew scripture, your Hebrew sources open. Can you tell me if that word days is supposed to be plural in the Hebrew, or is it a singular day?
Oh my.
I'm sorry, I was distracted.
No problem.
There's stuff happening.
Yeah. Leviticus 23:16.
Okay, yeah, I'm already there.
Okay. Now it says, until the morrow after the seventh Sabbath, you count 50 days, as in plural. Now that's what I have written in my scripture, and I am questioning, is that word yom, or is it yomim, plural?
Well, I looked at it in the KJV also, and it gives me a number for Strong's definition of H3117. And that Strong's number is a singular word known as yom.
Yes. So, until the morrow after the seventh Sabbath, that's your 49 days, up to that point, and that word until gives us a border where we stop counting 49. So, and it says there, you count 50 yom. That is a single day. It does not mean you count another 50. It means you count the 50th day, because that day is singular in the original Hebrew. But yet in our scriptures, it says days, as in plural. So that's not quite the way that the Hebrew words should, or what the Hebrew words intended. That's another infraction that we get when it's translated into English. Do you have more questions, Charlene?
No, I think everyone's doing really good. I was just thinking all along, boy, this just, the Joshua studies absolutely draw the line in the sand for everything. We've only done two slides. it's hard. But anyway, the rest of it's going to show this count, how it has to get to something else besides just 50. So I don't know. I think the next slide does have something, and they do specify 50 days on there. You'll see that. Does anybody know what LITV is? Because I'm not familiar with that version. Can somebody help us out?
I wanted to say something else real quick about Leviticus 23:16. It says, even unto the morrow after the seventh Sabbath. And the word even unto comes from the Strong's word H5704, add. And that means as far as.
Yes.
Even to, until, up to. So once you get to that point, you should have 50 days. It doesn't say after that, start counting 50 days. Up to that point, you should have 50 days. I just wanted to put that in there because apparently people have that misunderstood.
Very good point, Jesse. I really appreciate you bringing that out. Johnny, you have your hand raised?
If you don't have Hebrew or Strong's or something, if you read that in the English, it says seven complete Sabbaths. The next day after the seventh Sabbath, you shall number 50 days. Well, it's 50 days. In the English, it makes sense if you read it for what it is.
But what if you decided that it meant count an extra 50 days? Where would you prove that? Where would you go to prove that idea?
You can't prove it's an extra 50 days.
Why not?
there's only one other place that it talks about it, so it doesn't say that.
Can you tell me what other? Can you tell me what other place that is?
It'll take me a minute to find it here.
Okay, let me bring up the Exodus from Egypt. When did Moshe receive the Ten Deborim, or the Ten Commandments? Was that on the double count when he received the Ruach? Or was it an exact 50 days from the Omer count pattern when he left Egypt? Mark, you have your hand up. Do you want to answer? You have something for us?
Literal translation.
Mark, are you there?
Yeah, but my mic's not working.
Oh, I hear you good now.
Okay, you hear me now? It says it's cut off. Now, Moses went, you know, he came to give the Ten Commandments. So he went up on Shavuot. When he came back down when he came up, the Messiah gave him the Torah on Shavuot. Because that's what Shavuot represents, the giving of the Spirit. He gave the Spirit and the Torah. So to answer Charlene's question, LITB is the greens. It's a translation of the Bible, but this is by Wikipedia's definition. Literal translation of the Holy Bible by J.P. Greens. Do you know the J.P. Greens Interlinear? That's his book right here.
Yeah. Yeah. That's I have that is. Set.
And they say moon in there in that verse you was talking about earlier. And I don't remember what. I wrote it down somewhere here, but that's what it is. So, yeah, it was Shavuot that he gave the Torah.
But, Mark, what if it wasn't Shavuot? What if we are mistaken? What if our calculations are wrong and it is an extra count to Shavuot?
I don't see it that way because in that verse in Exodus, what you're just looking up, it's singular, Sabbath. Now, I've been questioned this before by believers. It's not plural. It isn't Sabbath. It's singular. It's Sabbath. So there's not seven extra weeks and then you count. It can't be.
So, okay, let's just say it is. At what point would that new count bring us to? What is the event that would bring us to, or that 99 count would bring us to? What is the mark in the scriptures that marks that at the end of that second count?
50 days after Shavuot.
Yeah. What is that count?
It's the worship of the golden calf.
Yes.
Right. When he came down with the...
Whoa, that's heavy. That's a nail in the coffin, man.
Yes.
Let's do it my way. We want to do it our way. Moses said, okay, you can. I'll break them.
So that second count to Shavuot that people would like to install, that would bring us to the worship of the golden calf. So my question to you is, shall we be worshiping on that day? And if we are worshiping on that day, what spirit are we worshiping?
False Trinity.
Thank you. Thank you. Excellent answer. Yes. If we are worshiping on the day that the golden calf was worshipped, we are honoring the God of the golden calf. Count me out, please. Okay, I still have two hands raised. Dana, your hand is raised still, as it always is. And Mark, your hand is still raised. Do you have something to say?
No, I don't know why my hand was raised. I'm practicing keeping my mouth shut. I'm letting the group do it.
Okay. So, Can somebody, I would like somebody to volunteer to read this verse on the screen, Leviticus 23, 15 to 16. Can somebody read that for us, please?
And you shall number H5608 to you from the next day after this Shabbat, from the day you bring in the sheaf of the wave offering. They shall be seven complete Shabbats. The next day after seventh Shabbat, you shall number, and then H5608, 50 days, and you shall bring near and new food offering to Yahuwah.
Thank you. So are we clear now that 50 days does not mean plural? It is designated as the 50th day, because the Hebrew word is yom and it is singular. I hope this is clear. Brenda, Brenda in Florida, you have your hand up, and then we're going to Barnabas. So Brenda, do you have something for us?
Tim?
Yes.
I just was thinking about what you said. When you said that if you worship on the day that they did the golden,
we lost you. We lost you there. Try again.
Okay. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. I was just thinking when you said that if you worship on the day that they were worshiping the golden calf, you would be worshiping the God that they were representing with the golden calf. And Tim, I just wanted to say that I thought that's stretching it a bit, because like in our modern time today, you know, there's so many different false religions and false gods. And I'm sure I don't even know what days they worship, but if we worship Yahuwah on a day that people happen to be worshiping another false god, we won't be worshiping that false god. So you're saying that, but is that just what you're saying because that's what you feel, or you think there's some scriptural basis to support that?
That is the day that Aharon declared was a feast day to the God that brought you out of Egypt. That is that they were paying allegiance to the God of the golden calf. That is why they were worshiping. When Moshe came down from the mount, he was brutally upset. So if we today are accepting that is the day that the Ruach was given, and we are worshiping on that day, we are paying allegiance to that construct that the golden calf, or the God of the golden calf, is what delivered them from Egypt. So if we pay allegiance to that, is our allegiance going to Yahuwah, or is it going to the God of the golden calf? That's the ultimate decision.
I do see what you're saying. It's like celebrating Easter, you know, or celebrating another pagan worship and celebrating a specific date. You're giving homage to another deity, a false deity. You know, sometimes by default, maybe we're trying to praise Yahuwah, but it's not in his appointed times. It is on a different time that was based on a pagan deity. So I can see the reflection and the how that can be associated with that, you know, how significant that can be, because it's not his Moedim. It's a different date altogether. We're using that date that was assigned to a different Elohim for us to pay homage to the true Elohim. So there is there's a synchronicity there.
But Jose, I'm gonna leave it. But Jose.
Yeah, go ahead. Sorry.
Well, maybe we could have Barnabas with his comment while we're waiting.
Yes.
Oh, okay. Wow, I'm not actually open on the scripture itself, but I just want to give a contribution in terms of the day. I mean, you were talking about the day they were worshiping the golden calf. I thought it was worshiping God, which was normal, but they used the golden calf to try to get to God through the golden calf, which means it could have happened on the actual on a worship day, but they were going through the golden calf.
Yes, I agree with you. They were going through the golden calf. They were taking the wrong avenue to worship our Creator.
Yeah, but it could have happened on a worship day.
Well, we do not have that instruction written in the scripture. And in fact, Moshe exhibited a very clearly and documented when the 50th day of the Omer count was, and that is when he went up Mount Sinai and received the Ten Commandments and the whole Melchizedek order there. That is the day of Shavuot. So this second count to Shavuot is a false count, and that is what we just brought out again in verse 16, where the word Yom is singular. It does not allow for an extra 50 days.
Okay. Can I just read the same from my version? I don't know if you understand me from that point, but let me just read that one again.
Sure.
And it's verse 15. And you shall count from the next Yom after the Sabbath, from the Yom that you brought the Omer of the wave offering, 7 full weeks, until the next Yom after the last week, you shall have numbered 50 days, and you shall offer a new grain offering to Yahweh.
Okay, I'd have to sit down and think on that one carefully in front of my face, because I am a slow thinker, and I would need to go over that. But from what we have studied in the Hebrew and what we have documented with Moshe, there's not a possibility that there was a second count to Shavuot.
I'd just like to make just a little point here with Exodus 32:4 and the worshiping of the golden calf. I don't think that Aaron was talking about the true Elohim. Let me just read it, because it reads a little bit different. This is the King James. And he received them at their hand and fashioned it with a graving tool after he had made it a molten calf. And they said, these be thy gods. It's plural, gods, O Israel, which brought thee up out of the land of Egypt. So I do not think that they were giving homage to the true Elohim, but this was plural. And the golden calf was indeed representing the sun god, the moon goddess, and the false messiah. So this wasn't an alternative that was a good alternative. I just wanted to bring that out.
Okay. Mark, I still see your hand up. Do you have something?
Hear me? No. Can you hear me now?
I can hear you.
Yep.
Oh, we lost you. Okay, Brenda from Florida, I see your hand up. Do you have something you'd like to say?
No, Tim, nothing else. I just forgot to lower my hand. Apologize.
Okay. So let's move a little bit forward here. Charlene, do you have something you would like to ask about this slide, or shall we move on?
I think we pretty much covered all of those, unless Jose has something to say.
Yeah, just really quick. I was just to answer the with a little more clarity about choosing the right modim, the right feast. This is also what, and I'm glad you brought up Isaiah 11 or 1:11 to 17, because that really made him angry that we did not follow his feast correctly. And they were paying homage to other deities or other traditions that were not exalting his commandments. So that's what Isaiah 1 is about. It's about him hating their Shabbats and their new moons and things like that that did not exalt him because they were just not listening to him, basically. So, and I can understand that sometimes certain holidays can fall by default, you know, during his Moedims, and that's fine. But so many times they don't. And I think, if I'm not mistaken, I think certain holidays like Easter, they do use the lunar to make it fit, the lunar calendar to make it fit in certain, to celebrate in certain days of the week. So they're still using the Halliel calendar or some of the lunar, you know, calendars to make that Easter fit, you know, for example. So that's another thing. They're elevating other days than his days in appointed times. And also another thing, because I see a lot of times when Yahuwah brings up certain things in regards to worshiping and also using certain things to worship, like the moon and the sun, it always does follow this, like, don't use the trees and then worship it, or don't use the moon or the sun and then worship it. Like, we still have to look at the moon, for example, for agricultural reasons, or the masa for certain things, right? But we're not supposed to just bow down and worship it. Is that what I'm understanding, or is it just don't even use it for it? I mean, at all, just use the shadow only and just keep our eyes up, because we do glean so much from the stars as well. So absolutely. I was kind of wondering.
Yeah, absolutely. There's let's go to this next paragraph at the bottom of this next slide, and we'll go rightly onto this topic. What is Abib? Genesis 1:14-16 requires that the sun, the moon, and the stars are to regulate periods of time. Therefore, there would have to be a star named Abib in order to anchor the year. What do we have comments on that? And the question I would ask it, what does the moon regulate? Because we know there are ordinances of the moon. So what, I would like somebody to tell me, what does the moon regulate?
What does the what? The moon what?
What does the moon regulate? What are the ordinances of the moon? What does it control?
The tides. The tides.
The agriculture, it's fixed in seasons, summer, winter, spring, and fall.
Yes, well. It's for agriculture, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yes.
The growing season.
Yes.
Tim, can I say something for a minute?
Certainly.
I know someone asked that question about the, you know, worshiping the golden calf, and I want to say something that comes from the Hebrew. There's a word that they use for strange gods, which is Elohim Akrim. And when we go and we worship Abba and any other day that he's ordained to be his days, we're taking things into our authority and making ourselves Elohim offering before him.
Yes.
So for anyone to say that we're not, that we can call it whatever it may want to be, but, you know, how many times have he told us, you know, he's going to drive us out before those strange gods into the land where we are at? And I don't know, we can do hermeneutics, we can do whatever. If Abba tells us to worship him on this day and we have the knowledge of the calendar which we have, we better do it.
Yeah, I think so too. Yeah. Jose, you have your hand up, and then I see there's a number ending in 8250. You will come after Jose. Go ahead, Jose. Oh, Jose removed his number. Okay, how about, okay, sorry. The 8250, do you have something to say to us?
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Well, okay, sorry. I've gotten all confused with where my numbers are and off and on. And I was just, it's William here. I was just wanting to share about the moon. It was for growing seasons. A lot of people plant their gardens according to the moon. That's all I wanted to share. Sorry for, so I'll put it back off. I'll take my hand down again. Sorry.
No, don't be sorry, William. We appreciate your input there. Yes, agriculture is huge with the moon. It's huge. We have Henry Hamilton with his hand up. Do you have something for us, Henry?
Yeah, the calendar that we've been talking about, where does that calendar come from?
Charlene, do you know the origin of this calendar?
No, I am sorry. I cannot tell you. I do not know. It was just sent to us 1 week ago. I have no idea where it's been generated from. At this point in time, sorry.
Okay.
Was so it just emailed to you?
Yeah,
yes, it was emailed to me, yes.
Well, then you know who emailed it.
Yeah, but that's not who wrote the calendar.
That wasn't who generated it. I'm sorry. The name has been removed from the PowerPoint before it was sent to me, so I don't know.
Eric, in Tennessee, do you have something to say?
Just by chance, I think I might know, but I don't know the name of the guy for sure, but I just have to make a couple of phone calls because this actually got brought up last night at our Passover meeting. And I will do some detective work and I will find out because evidently this is something new that has come out. And there's a gentleman that's going around teaching it. He's got a power video series. I believe this is the calendar that was talked about last night. And I'll see if I can find out where it came from.
Well, it's where it came from is not as important as the substance of what the calendar is. What is it? Did it derive from the Torah? Is it truth, or is it something that cannot be, that has no foundation in the Torah? That's the important part.
And it doesn't. It doesn't have any foundation in the Torah.
That's correct. Yes.
Henry, I would just like to make another comment. This is part 11, so I have not seen parts 1 to 10 of this study. This happens to be part 11. So I have no idea what parts 1 to 10. I have not seen that. So just to let you know.
And Henry Hamilton, you still have your... Oh, he took your hand down. Okay, that's fair enough. Do you have more for us, Eric?
Yep, that'll do it.
Okay. Okay.
Tim?
Yes.
This is Pastor Don.
Yes.
I want to tell you that I'm listening with my spirit. And everything you and Charlene are saying is true. I'm a farmer I was raised on the farm. And everything you're saying that you're finding in the scriptures, I can tell you is true. Thank you.
Thank you, Don. You're a farmer. Do you also understand that when you dehorn cattle, it should be done by the phases of the moon so that it lessens the bleeding of when the horn is removed? Have you heard that?
Yes, it could be. There are many farmers that I know of that are saying what you're saying is true. They don't have the technical that you are getting, but I can tell you for a fact it is true.
Yes. So the moon has very, very definite ordinances. I don't want people to think that we're putting down the moon or putting down a creation of Yahuwah. Far from it. The moon is an absolutely fascinating identity. I thoroughly enjoy seeing it up there. It has its purpose, a very definite purpose, and we are not removing that from it. What we are trying to do is ascertain what purpose it has and what purpose or what it is that starts the year, the worship Moedim year of Yahuwah. That's why we're trying to go over this calendar. Do you have any comments on that, Charlene?
No, it's just that there are a lot of ordinances of the moon, and especially when it comes to agriculture, it's basically based on the agricultural portion of the seasons, not yes. worship seasons. So when it yes. says in Psalms 104:19, the moon knows the worship seasons or whatever it says there, this is not talking about Moed worship seasons. This is talking about agricultural seasons, that the moon right. works in conjunction with the sun, the push and the pull. So yes, the moon is really important. And of course, the harvests do follow the feast. That is true. But if we didn't have the moon up there to give us the harvests, they wouldn't be in alignment with the feast. So that's just a short nugget.
Yes. Johnny, you have your hand up.
Yeah, I had to step out for a second, but Joan said you were wondering who that calendar might have come from. I believe I know it's Michal Shabbat Scriptural Studies, and they're all over YouTube, and they have a lot of videos, and the moon is a number one.
Well,
from where?
It's called Michal Shabbat Scriptural Studies on YouTube.
Michal Shabbat. Okay.
It's too bad it's not scriptural. That's the problem with it. It has no foundation in the Torah. That's a serious problem.
All of his scriptural verses are non-Torah verses.
Wow. Wow.
Wow is right.
That goes a long hey, ways. Yes.
The word Spica does not mean Abib. Can you scroll back down? Can you bring back where it was talking about the word of in the Maseroth with Petula? Yeah, Spica is one of the brightest stars in the heavens. It represents one of the roles of the Messiah, which is in the Sphinx. In one hand, she's holding a branch. In the other hand, she's holding the first fruits. It's not the name of the month. Spica is the name of us, the first fruits. This is a very fraudulent calendar.
Yes. Tim, if you can just roll it back one more slide, that will have a little bit of explanation. We should probably read that, because what they did right here is they went on a bunny trail, and you're going to see what the bunny trail is. I think, Tim, maybe if you could read this, they're going to now zero in on Spica for a very specific reason. It's a bunny trail, and we'll come up to it here in a little bit, probably around slide 13 or something like that. Tim, could you read that?
Yes. Abib refers to Spica, observed, or rather, according to the marginal reading, a night of observations. The bright star, Spica, which marks the ears of corn in the Virgin's hand, rose above the eastern horizon as the sun set in the west, and at midnight must have shone brilliantly on the Hebrew hosts. For Spica is so bright a star that even the beams of the full moon, riding close at hand, could not have obscured its luster. The Indians of today name their months from the stars in their lunar zodiac. I'm getting a lot of noise on someone's microphone here. If we could have your microphones muted, I would greatly appreciate it. I'll start that last paragraph again.
Sorry.
No problem. The Indians of today name their months from the stars in their lunar zodiac, which are in opposition to, not from those in conjunction with the sun. The close resemblance of the Arab and the Indian lunar zodiacal series suggests the thought that the Arabs may have followed the same system of month nomenclature as the Indians. Okay, what are the comments on this?
I didn't find it in the Bible as a bee being translated as a star, so that's if we're going to base, I believe they're going to be using to determine when the harvest starts in Abib, in the crops of the green, the green of the crops, And they're using Abib as a reference on when that time is going to start. Abib itself is not referenced in the Bible as a star, but as the greening of the crops. So that I always, you know, somebody tried to bring that up to my attention, but I go, well, show me in the Bible where it says Abib is a star. And that, you know, I understand that. I understand what I'm reading right now. And maybe some people started worshiping as a star or whatever, but it's not something that I found to be biblical.
Thank you, Jose. Appreciate that. Do you have more, Charlene?
No, I think that there's I don't think we need to spend too much time on the next two slides, but then on slides 13 and 14, they're going to go into some Exodus chronology. If you want to move that up a little bit, Tim, I'll just go over a little bit. We're never going to get through this PowerPoint tonight, but yeah, just back up one more, Tim. Just back one up more one slide. More. I think. Oh no. It was right. You had it right. Sorry about that. After that, speak a one. Mm-hmm. It'll come up. Okay, this one here, Exodus 12:1-2. We know what it says. And Yahuwah spoke unto Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, "This month shall be unto you the beginning of months." It's 23:20, Kodesh, not Yerek. "It shall be the first month of the year to you." Then they go on to say, "And on a 360-day year," this is very interesting, "this would have also been the spring equinox, and Moses would have seen the perfect shadow cast over the pyramids at sunrise." I'd just like you to advance it to the next slide, because then it gets really interesting. We're going to go back to Spica and see what else they have to say. I'd like some comments on this. However, the equinox is not the official marker as to note when the year begins, because we cannot see it with the naked eye. What did they say just before this? Then he goes on to say, "Moses would have also seen the sunrise and a full moon setting as per the requirements in Genesis 1:14-16. Okay, they're putting the moon in there. But isn't it interesting that they say you cannot see the equinox when the shadow on the ground is exactly what you see? And the pyramids today that have been standing there for thousands of years are still marking the equinox today. And we know that in, what is it, Acts 7:22, that Moses was very trained in the ways of the Egyptians. They knew what they were doing to mark the equinox. So when they say here, the equinox is not the official marker of when the year begins, what do you think they're actually saying is the official marker? Because they've already told you what it is. That's my question.
Speak up.
He's using the moon and the stars out of Torah.
Yeah. So then they go on to use this verse, Psalms 104:19. This is the popular verse to get the moon in there. And it's not a Torah verse. Remember that. It says, "He made the moon for the appointed times." When you actually look this up, it is 4150 Moed. That is absolutely true. But when you do a full and proper study of these appointed times, the very first definition of the appointed times is your agricultural seasons. I was taught, and I think many of you were as well, that 4150 means worship appointed times, ever and only worship appointed times. That is not true, because when you look in Jeremiah at the stork, she also has appointed times, 4150, and this has got nothing to do with worship statutes. But this is the verse that's used in Psalms 104. Now, the interesting thing about this chapter, if you read the whole context, it's all about something that was happening at creation and what the lights in the sky, what they were put there for. Yes, the moon is put there for seasons, but it is not worship seasons. It's the agricultural seasons. So if anybody wants to comment to that, I'll end it there.
Amen.
Yeah, Frank,
really,
I also
really manipulate.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
we
really
do,
manipulate.
We do have some hands up here, Danan, so I'm going to go to Frank first. His hand's been up for a while. Frank, do you have something you'd like to add?
Hi, everyone. How are you doing?
Hi, Daisy.
I just wanted to reiterate some of the stuff that we talked about the last time I presented on the equinox. You know how you were just recently talking about the issue with adding the extra time, the extra week? I think it's for Shavuot where it changed the count. And I think someone made a comment as to how it may or it may not be something deliberate, and that Aaron, you know, made a mistake or this and that. And then someone else interjected and said that Yah was very specific about what he wanted, and the results, I think it was Jose who said that the results show that he was very displeased, and it was summed up in the book of Isaiah. So what I see there is a lot of presuppositions with information and mixture. And that is the caution that I say, and that I just wanted to bring in with these stars and with these constellations. This gentleman who has presented this calendar has, it seems like there's just a lot of mixture, and there's a lot of stuff that's not even in the scriptures. So when it comes to the stars, there's a lot of mixture. And there's a lot of freedom and liberty in associating things that are actually not rooted in the word. And then we take it and we apply it to Yah and superimpose some personal views. So I just wanted to mention that, just have caution when it comes to that. That was it.
Thank you, Daisy. We appreciate that. Jesse, you have your hand up.
Yeah, I was just wanting to go over the Psalms 104 verse, you know, because I dig into the Hebrew every chance I get. And when you look at the wording, you know, he appointed the moon for seasons. It doesn't say the appointed times of the Father. It says for seasons. The sun, this is according to the KJV, the sun knoweth his going down. So if you look at the word that it uses for his going down, the word it uses is mabo. Mabo means entrance, coming in. So it seems like there's a little, you know, a little translator confusion right there. You know, is it referring to the sun's exiting of the sky? Or is it referring to the sun's entrance into the day? I mean, or maybe it's talking about the sun knows when the moon goes down. You know, it's I just don't understand. I just don't understand how, you know, how he gets that he made the moon for appointed times. When it's clearly referencing seasons and not, you know, the beginning of months or the year.
Well, the moon has very definite agricultural application for the seasons, and that is the appointed times of the moon.
We're talking about agricultural seasons, not worship seasons, Jesse. Does that help? Yeah.
No, I understand that. I understand that, but I don't think they do.
No,
whoever came
no, you're
up
right.
With this calendar, I don't think they understand that.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Because
this
see
particular
this for what it says according to the Hebrew. I don't see this for the confusing English words that can be mixed and matched to phrase it how you want it to be perceived. When you take it back to the Hebrew, it can't be confused.
Right. So this verse actually links up to Deuteronomy 33:14, where it talks about the moon and it's provided for precious bounties, okay? The precious bounties that it gives us to provide food for the earth and for the sea animals.
Amen.
Yeah. Jose, you have your hand up?
Yeah,
I didn't want to take up too much time because I know Charlene and you want to get through these a little bit quicker. But just real quick, just go back and just do a recap on Psalms 104:19. If you look at the context before and after, it all talks about how the seasons affect the world that live around us. Never does it say it's actually made to a point from one time to another. Nothing at all in that whole Psalms declares that. So that in context, they would have even taken that out of context completely. But if you look at the context, it really is a beautiful Psalms that allows us to see how the sun and the moon affect, you know, the world that we live around us in a seasonal way.
Right.
Okay, Charlene.
So in the next part, there's several slides where they're going to go through the Exodus chronology. And Tim, you can just move the slides slowly as I talk about them. But they want you to see, when the 10th day of the month was, that was when the lamb was chosen. And then they want to show on the next slide, that's right, they want to show Passover is always on the 14th. They just kind of go through this very, very step by step. They also, on the next slide after that, they show that that was the day that they put the blood on the doorpost there in Exodus 12:7. Then on the next slide, they're showing you that this was also the night where the death angel passed over. You'll see they have sort of a death angel there or something on the 14th. And then, interesting enough, on the slide after this, they deviate from Torah and look what we find. We have the book of Jasher, which is interesting. So this is a calendar that is now dipping into something other than Torah, but they're using Jasher to say what Torah said. So I kind of winked at that a little bit. And the next slide is very interesting. It tells you when they pulled up stakes. It says in Numbers 33:3 that they pulled up stakes from Ramses in the first month on the 15th day of the first month. That is really important. We have stressed that quite a bit. And it says on the next day, which was the day after Passover, because we know the 15th follows the 14th, that's where they went out from the bondage of the Egyptians. But some of you may remember that the 15th date was also on the midst of the week day. So we've talked about that quite a bit in our former studies. They just keep on going there. And then there's quite a bit of when did they leave Egypt? We all know that they left on the middle day of the week. But look what they've got. Well, I don't know. They've got the 15th as a Sabbath. I don't know which day of the week it is because they just say it's a Sabbath, whether it was a moon Sabbath or not. So you have no way to pin that down. And they talk about what happened on that night there about Moses. That's right, Tim. Great, great. Talking about Moses, you know, taking the bones of Joseph out of the land. And then he comes back on the next slide, comes back to Jasher. So he's getting his witnesses out of Jasher, which I guess they can do that if they want to. But as you continue going, you'll find they're coming now back to Exodus 13 and talking about camping from Sukkot and going to Etham and the edge of the wilderness, etc. And then we are going to look at the next slide. Sabbath language for the 15th of the month. is the fifth and a date. We talked about this a lot. This is a really important principle. Was it a day or is it a date? And some of our new people might not exactly be able to follow this. But let me just read Deuteronomy 5:15. And remember that you were a slave in the land of Egypt, and Yahuwah your Elohim brought you out from there by a mighty hand and by an outstretched arm. On account of this, Yahuwah your Elohim has commanded you to keep the Sabbath day. So what did they have there? They've got a stop sign right on the 15th. This is the first month out of the Exodus. Tim, did you see something they left out after the 14th? When, I'm pretty sure you did, because what did it say? On the what they've got happening on the next slide is that they have the stop at the 15th, and then what do they do, Tim? They've got 3 days there in orange. Do you see what they're doing?
They have 3 days of travel. They traveled heavily for 3 days. On the 18th, they would have traveled for 24 hours. They would have crossed the Red Sea that night. Did they get a rest on the 19th? Was that the Sabbath that they stopped and they were praising Yahuwah?
Yeah, you see this... There's just so much going on here. I wonder if we have some calendar panel members that want to comment on what they're seeing happening here. Anybody? Do you see any problems?
When did the wave sheaf pattern start on this calendar?
On Shabbat.
Wave sheaf pattern.
Oh, the 16th, right?
Yes.
Right.
Why is the 16th a problem? Charlene, do you want to fill? Go ahead.
You're supposed to wave the wave sheaf after tomorrow, the Sabbath, and that would be the 15th.
Well, they have the Sabbath as the 15th, and the wave chief here would have been on the 16th. So if that is always on the 16th, what is the problem with the wave chief always being on the 16th? Who is that associated with?
That's what was that guy's name?
That rabbi, that Rashbi?
Yes.
Exactly.
That is a direct association with a rabbi that died. And now, correct me if I'm wrong, Charlene, wasn't that the one and the day that he introduced the I lost my terminology here. The mystic.
The Kabbalah.
Yeah, Kabbalah. He's the one that died and introduced the Kabbalah on the 16th. So they like to associate, or they like to have the wave sheaf on the 16th, or all certain calendars.
Yeah, just let me put a little bit more detail in there. He died on the 33rd day of the Omer count, and it could be that year that he died that the Omer count, that the 16th could have been the Omer count that year.
Yeah.
But they commemorate the wave sheaf to the 16th of Abib every single year. Because of his death, they commemorate it. So from that date, and I'm trying to remember, was that about 160, 180 AD? I can't remember for sure, but it was quite a ways after Yahusha was here on the earth. But they have married Abib 16 to Wave Sheaf. But now this is the month of the Exodus. They were not commanded to keep the Wave Sheaf at this time because the instructions were you don't keep the Wave Sheaf until you come into the land of Canaan. But mind you, Yahuwah was counting his Omer count, and he knew that they had to get to 50 days for the Shavuot. But they're trying to show you something a little bit different here. So they don't realize that Moses' Passover in this particular year was actually on the third cycle or a Tuesday. You count 3 days of travel, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. They would have crossed the Red Sea Friday night, all night long. Jesse can talk to you an hour about that. And then at the dawning of the Sabbath, the weekly Sabbath, which would have been actually 14, 15, 16, 17, would have been the 18th, right, Tim?
Yes.
14, 15, 16, the 18th would have been the weekly Sabbath. Yeah. So there's just a lot of problems with this particular side. Is anybody wanting to comment?
Johnny has his hand raised.
Yeah, if you, from this slide to the previous slide, they're violating their own calendar. Because Torah says they left the day after the Passover. These guys are saying they observed the daylight Sabbath. But if you're following a moon calendar, that completely eliminates the 15th then. So they're violating their own calendar.
Yes.
Is it,
I just don't know how I can make hands yet. I don't know. Anybody else? Henry?
I was saying, could the guy who said that just repeat what he said? What about?
Torah says they left the day after the Passover. The next day, it says. Okay, well, these guys are saying, well, no, they observed the Sabbath. Well, if you're on a moon calendar, the day starts in the evening, so that eliminates leaving that day. They couldn't have left that day. So they've already violated Torah, and they haven't even got to the next slide yet.
They've literally hung themselves.
That's a really good observation, Johnny. That's really good.
Now, are you saying...
So a new moon calendar does what?
The moon, if you're on a moon calendar, you start the day in the evening. And they admitted that they observed the Sabbath during the daylight hours, so that cuts out that whole day.
Yep.
So you're saying that this calendar is based on a... evening to evening day? This is not a dawn day start. They don't
seeing this is always an evening calendar because they're starting day number one that they don't count with the evening moon. That's how they get the new moon day, so it has to be an evening moon calendar.
Yes.
They've violated their own interpretation between of how.
So a moon calendar violates what?
I said they violated their own calendar with Torah.
This is a gathering of all the calendars in one. Jose, share a little bit on your research on this. This is a compilation of all the calendars in one calendar. It's just unbelievable what they've done with this thing.
Yeah. That's what it seems like. They just want to pick and choose from different areas. I mean, I knew someone, whether or not this is a person or not, but I knew someone that did take the time to go to different congregations and put everything together from different ideas, different things. And just, it was just a mixture of so many different ways of figuring out the days and the evenings. And until it just made, the math made right in their logical sense. But at the same time, it is not something that is based on Torah. And they also, it's an anti-Mashiach spirit that did this. Because what they're doing, they're also... taking the the first fruits ascension to heaven, okay, that Yahusha, and they're trying to apply that on the second month, okay? They're trying to say that this is something, there's two Passover, so they're saying that he went and he had his first fruits on the second month, okay? Meaning that they had a second first fruits for the second month. I mean, it really takes the salvation of Yahuwah and the Son away completely. They're stripping that away because they're saying that Yahusha was not raised in the first fruits, okay, of the month of Abib, but it was extended to the second month. And so, yeah, so it's an anti, to me, spiritually, the source of our true doctrine is based on the fact who Yahushua truly is. You know, he is sitting on the right hand of the Father. We cannot, say that he was defiled, or he was, that he was unclean, he sinned. You know, we can't say, we have to really give him the position that he deserves of authority in our lives. And you see these people bringing him down, and just trying to make him fit their own perception of calendar, as opposed to putting his works of salvation to introduce what a true calendar is supposed to mean. And so we have to look at the fulfillments of Yahushua being raised on first fruits of the first month, and not, trying to say that he may have been unclean or was a stranger in the land, and that allowed him to be ascended on the second month. I mean, it's just very, we're nowhere in scripture even points to that, So it's, to me, it's just a very anti-Mashiach spirit that's behind this.
Anti what?
Antichrist, anti-Mashiach. An antichrist spirit, an anti-Mashiach spirit. Because they're taking their works away of salvation from Yahushua. Because they care more about making this fit their idea. They care more about that than the works, the fulfillment of what Mashiach had to go through to be first fruits, as Paul said. He is our first fruits. Mashiach is our first fruits. Mm-hmm. So they're stripping that away by saying that he ascended in the second month.
Care about what?
Saying that Yahushua was basically given a pass to celebrate his Passover on the second month, as opposed to the first month. Like Numbers 9 has the what Yahuwah did for out of his mercy for those who touched the dead corpse and those who were strangers of the land. He added an inclusion of those who were not able to celebrate, where they were able to keep Passover on the second. Applying that, even though that was only Passover, by the way, it doesn't say anything there about Feast of Unleavened Bread or anything. It doesn't say anything about anything else. They're still applying that all the way to the New Testament, basing their whole 99-day calendar, 99 days from his resurrection, from first fruit, all the way. And so basically they were saying that Yahushua was raised on the second Passover using Numbers 9, okay? Basically Yahushua was not able to fulfill the correct Passover according to covenant. Basically, that's what they were saying, okay? And so, and so there's no scriptural basis, because I had somebody try to challenge me on this, and I'm like, well, where's the scripture that backs this up? Because according to Torah, the feasts of Unleavened Bread and Passover, they're two different feasts. Even though they group them together, and you can call it a festival, because you see that in the New Testament. But if you look at it, there's still two different ordinances and rules to each one. So they really have to do a lot of gymnastics to try to make this fit their view. And it's not Torah based. It's basically something that they assume, or they just assume, because it's an anti-Mashiach spirit. They're basically taking away the ascension to the altar in heaven and the mercy seat to deliver his blood on first fruits. They're saying he did that on the first month, but on the second month. Like Yahushua needed that extra time because he could not fulfill the first true Passover that Yahuwah wanted him to fulfill. I mean, it's like really, I mean, you don't want, you're talking about the Savior. You're talking about Yahuwah that came to do the works in his son, and now you're dragging him down to associating him with being unclean, associating him with being a strange, far off land, and not able to fulfill the Father's commandment as well. I mean, you're really taking, so, and then you're not even delivering your blood to heaven of first fruits, like Paul said, he is our first fruits, and you can only have first fruits in the first month. You cannot have it on the second month. That's another thing. How can you make that fit? You cannot have first fruits on the second month. That has to do with agriculture. That has to do with the heart, the you know, the expectancy of what, you know, the harvest to come. You know, it's all like, ah. Oh. Anyway, but anyway, I think if we just stick with the word, and stick with the foundation of the and the glorification of Yahuwah and the Son in heaven, we should have any problems, and just, you know, allow him to speak out based on his fulfillment of his ascension, and not allow all this other people try to put their calendar before himself. Sorry, I just a little passionate about it.
Can I don't know if my hand's up. Oh no, it's not.
No, it's not. We do have some other people ahead of you, Henry. We will get to you. Hendry Grobler, you have your hand up. Would you like to speak to us? I can't really understand what you're saying. No, I can hear you now.
Can you get, I hear you, but can you hear me now?
Very difficult. I think we're going to have to pass on and go to Eric from Tennessee. Eric, you have something for us?
I believe that nominate Johnny, Jose, and Jesse to put together the perfect PDF PowerPoint presentation that rebuts this whole thing.
I look forward to it. Okay, Henry Hamilton, you have something for us?
And I want the Maseroth.
Henry Hamilton, do you have something for us?
I did, and I forgot. Come back to me.
Okay. Betty Schultz, you're up next. Do you have something that you would like to say?
This whole thing, and thank you, Jose. That was so wonderful what you taught us. What I see is a tickling of the ears that we, you know, used to look for when we were sitting in the pews of the church. And so many people that I have had experience with get so romantically connected to Yasher and all of those extra books. And they are interesting. I found myself reading some of them, but I think that's where some of the danger is, and that we need to be aware and maybe keep some of our friends from stumbling, because it's a huge pull on people. And so I am just so grateful to Yahuwah for bringing me to this group, because I didn't know where to go with calendar. I was just willing to follow anybody because nobody seemed to know, and nobody taught. They just accepted. So thank you so much. I'll be quiet now.
Thank you, Betty. And Betty, your input.
Yeah. And Betty, that is so true. These other books, they may have some historical value. There may be some value for historical points. But when it comes to calendar, we have not seen that they've been in alignment with Torah. We've seen that consistently. And that is where I'm not going to put the books down 100%. There could be some historical information there that is helpful. I don't know how you check it out, but for calendar reasons, we do not rely on those extra books, okay? Just for everybody to know that.
Henry Hamilton, I'm coming back to you. Do you remember what you have to share with us?
I'm not at my paper at the moment. I don't have my question with me.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Okay, so Tim, could you pop up to slide 37? We're going to kind of skip over their second month and their quail and manna. That can go on for 2 hours just doing that. But on slide 37 and 30, 37 and 38. So let's do 37 first.
I can't see the numbers on my screen, Charlene. So there's the quail.
I think they're up in the corner, up in your upper left corner.
Oh, yep,
I think
there it is.
34, 35.
Okay, yeah. what slide do you want me on?
On 37, we're going to skip the second month. It's not going to be right, but we're not going to explain it tonight. But on slide 37, yeah, one more. Yes, this is the one. When did they leave Egypt? Okay, so we've kind of discussed this a little bit, that they actually left Egypt on the 15th. It was the day after Passover. That is very, very clear. Okay. Let me see what their version says. And they pulled up stakes from Ramsey in the first month on the 15th day. So Johnny is absolutely right. That's what it says in Torah. And that's exactly what they did. But then they showed, remember, they had the stop sign on the 15th. And it does say here on the next day after the Passover is when they went out with a high hand. And that is absolutely true. In order to do that, according to the Torah calendar instructions, Passover would have been on the third cycle. Of course, we can't tell here what's going on because their Sabbaths can be on any cycle of the week. But this is now coming up to the difference of a day or a date. And we saw exactly the same problem in the Enoch calendar where, because the next slide is going to show the third month. And I think, Tim, you could pop up to the next slide after this. This is exactly the same problem that we had with Enoch. They wanted, an Enoch calendar does put every single Passover on a third cycle or a Tuesday. At least the majority of them do. So they have the Egyptian Passover on a Tuesday, and that was true, okay? But when it says here in Exodus 19:1, they weren't very careful about what they were reading, okay? So in that calendar, you will see number 15 is highlighted in a blue square, and they want you coming into Shavuot on the 15th, which they say is the same date as when they left Egypt. So let's read what 19:1 says. And in the third month of the departure of the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, on the same day. It does not say on the same date. They did depart Egypt on the 15th, the day after Passover, but they did not come into the land for Shavuot on the same date. It says very clearly, right, Tim? It says yes. The same day.
Yay.
The day, and this is not Shavuot. This is the day that they're actually, what does it say? They came into the wilderness of Sinai. At this point in time, they are not at the mountain yet. So they didn't read a little bit more. In fact, Exodus 19 is so important. They only read verse 1. If you keep reading, it doesn't take very long till you find out, oh, I think they're going to have it. In the next one there. Well, that's Exodus 19:2. Yeah, see here at Exodus 19:2, it says now that they're pitching before the mountain. So this is, if everybody remembers, we emphasize this a whole lot in the Joshua Sickle, that there is a principle and there's a big difference between a day and a date. The day of the week, being the 15th, was a Wednesday or the middle day of the week. But the 15th is not always on a Wednesday, okay? But they're using it as their Sabbath there. They're using it as a lunar Sabbath. So, Tim, do you want to comment any more about that?
I think you did very well on that, Charlene.
Well, anyway, then they go on to do their, they continue on, and they want to do their next count. And it's very interesting what they do. I think we can skip a couple slides here. I'm not sure. Let me see. Up to slide 47, 48, perhaps.
Oh, way up there.
They've got a lot of just it looks like, everybody, that they've put a lot of detail and a lot of work into this. But you know what? If you start off on the wrong foot, you're going to end up being wrong all the way through. So Exodus 24:4. Good. That's exactly. Exodus 24:4. And Moses wrote all the words of Yahuwah. And Moses rose up early in the morning, and he built an altar under the mountain and set up 12 stones for the 12 tribes of Israel. Well, we know about this. At this point in time, boy, it's too bad we didn't have the covenant calendar right beside this, Tim, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
It's very confusing to explain this without the covenant calendar right beside it. But what they did not have Shavuot on the 15th. In this particular year, let me see if I can remember, it was the 8th of the month. It was not the 15th. So this is some of the Enoch calendar that's coming into play. But they don't even have that right, because they're saying that the 15th was a Sabbath. And so they're actually putting the 16th as Shavuot, I would say, because Shavuot is not on a Sabbath. It's always the day after. And then they've got 3 days there. They've got 17, 18, and 19. And there was some important things that were happening on those dates. I wonder if anybody can remember what was happening, because they're not going to show it. They're not going to show it. They're going to show you something else. If you can pop up to slide 49. And just everybody take a look at the next one coming up. And slide 49. Here we go. They have got in 24:18, and Moses came up into the midst of the cloud, and he went up into the mountain, and Moses was in the mountain 40 days and 40 nights. Now, covenant calendar members, I'm going to ask you a question that our new members won't know the answer, but you should know. On Shavuot Day, when Yahuwah spoke the first 10 words, what was the next thing that happened after that? The very next thing that happened after he spoke the 10th word.
There was lightning, and didn't he go, there was an altar that got built?
No.
Oh, am I going too far?
What did the people, oh yes, you are going too far. The very next thing the people said, Moses, we can't handle this. You talk to us, but we can't handle anymore. We're going to die if Yahuwah talks anymore to us. Do you remember the mountain was trembling? It was an earthquake. There was smoke and there was fire, and they were scared to death. And they went to Moses, just like it always happened in chapter 19, and they said, Moses, you go up the mountain and go get the rest of the words, because we'll listen to you. Do you all remember that? And that is exactly what Moses did on Shavuot. It was not the 16th. It was the 8th of the month, according to covenant calendar. And he was up there. And then he came back down, and he read the words to the, he gave the words to the people. And they said, all that Yahuwah has said, what? We will do, right?
We'll do. Yep.
And then they skipped all these verses. If Tim wants to move back a little bit, you'll see all these verses. They did not do them. These first verses in Exodus 24, between verses 1 to 11, they skipped a whole bunch of details here. So Moses gave them the words. They said, yep, that's exactly what we heard. Then he wrote the words in a book, and then he got the sacrifices all ready, and then he read the words out of the book. And what did the people say? Jose, I'm going to ask you, what did the people say for the third time?
We will do as you say. Vow of faith.
Yes.
Do the things that were written.
Absolutely. They said, and be obedient. That's what they said. And be obedient. So did you happen to notice when Tim was moving those slides around that they skipped all the way from Exodus 24:7 to 24:18. And there is an incredible amount of detail in those scriptures that they skipped. Do you remember what happened after he blood ratified that book of the covenant and he blood ratified the people. What was the very next thing that Moses was told to do by Yahuwah? He said, you're going to come up this mountain again, but who are you going to bring? Do you remember how many people went up the mountain again?
70?
73.
A little bit more.
72?
Oh, that's right. Moses.
It was Moses, Joshua, and the 70 elders.
And?
Yeah. It was Aaron. And his
Aaron,
two sons.
Sorry, not two sons, right. I'm sorry, Aaron. So it's 74.
75, because Joshua was there too.
Yeah. Okay.
So they never told you this. They never told you that they went, 75 men, everybody, 75 men are going up into partway up Mount Sinai. And what are they going to do up there? Anybody? What are they going to do up there?
Covenant confirming meal.
That's right.
Have a meal.
So we were saying we can make a reasonable assumption here. Okay. We did do a reasonable assumption because we're not given the time frame. But for 75 men to kill sacrifices and have a covenant confirming meal and to eat together and drink together, and that's exactly what it says in Exodus 24 about verse 11, that they did eat and drink. We said that that was probably a two-day event, and I'm pretty sure there was no women there to help them, so I think it took them at least 2 days to complete this covenant confirming meal. Does anybody remember what happened after those 2 days were over with? They don't tell you about it in this study.
Didn't Moses tell them to hang out or go back down, and they were going to go up to the mount and hang out with Yahusha?
Well, that was one of the instructions. He said, Joshua and I are going, and we want you to stay right here until we come back, unless there's a difficulty. But they were supposed to wait there. And it does tell you that Moses and Joshua went partway up the mountain. There's three levels on this trip getting to the top, and waited there for 7 days. And then Yahuwah called Moses separately to the very top of the mountain on the seventh day. Whether it was a Sabbath or not, we're not discussing that was a weekly Sabbath, but it was on the seventh day of that trip. They left that all out. There's nothing here at all. So what they are doing now is that they are starting their count, their second Shavuot count, okay? On the 19th, they've got number one there. And they are now going to count out 40 days of Moses being in the mountain. But they did not put in the 7 days that happened before he started his 40 days. Does everybody see that? If you go to the next slide, they will continue their count, but before you go, look at this day 30. Guess what, everybody? It gets a count. They never counted it before, but now it's getting a count. It's the 12th day. When you go to the next slide, I want you to observe what's happening on the next slide and tell me what you see. We'll give you a little bit of time to look at it and what days they're counting. And what's going on here?
Well, they're not counting the 29th or the 30th.
At the end of the month, but that's because they're saying they're only counting Moses 40 days, right?
They're counting the first day.
So.
Yeah, I was going to say.
they counted the first day. So, you know, they never gave you any Torah scriptures that said, Well, now we count the first days and the last days, you know, now you do the switch rule. There was nothing there, nothing at all. No Torah, not even no apocryphal books, no Dead Sea Scrolls, nothing, you know. It's like, oh my goodness, there's a lot that could be said here. But don't forget, everybody, that this is not Moses' 40th day, because there was 7 days before he started his 40th day. It just gets worse and worse. I don't know what to say. I just don't know what to say. You know, if you count this out properly, Tim, up to slide 54, we'll just move it ahead a little bit, because they do say that on the 40th day, Moses' 40th day, when he comes down the mountain, oh, guess what, everybody? There's a golden calf there. But you know what? This is 7 days early. This is not where the golden calf was. The golden calf is 7 days past this. So there's just a lot of problems. Just a lot.
That's an understatement.
This is being recorded, so it can be shared with whoever is you know, there's people being caught in the snare of this calendar, and they're not seeing the other side because they haven't been shown it. But people that are seeing this, if they don't understand covenant calendar, they have nothing to fight back with. They have nothing to question because it all looks so good. And I bet you anything, most of the people aren't going and looking at Exodus 24 to see if they left any details out, because most people aren't looking. Tim, I don't know if you want to just pop up to slide number, I think it's 58. We should probably end this pretty soon.
Yeah. Here's 58.
Because I think everyone's getting weary.
Yeah.
I think we axed it a long time ago.
Yes.
But this is going to show you a recap of the first, second, third month. Here again, you will get to see that in the first month, they didn't count day 30 in their 7 times 7 weeks. They didn't count day 1. In the second month. They didn't count day 30 in the second month. They didn't count day 1 in the third month to get to their 7 times. They left those days out. But somehow, when they count the next 50, or 7 times 7 plus 1, then they add in these 30s and these number 1s. So no explanation, nothing at all from Torah.
I think Noah would have a big problem with this calendar.
And then in the next slide is the review of continuing the count. And you can see in the next slide where they do count those days. And we're already into, 60 slides. But the calendar was declared a counterfeit way back there on that first slide with the chart. It was already a counterfeit, because Joshua said that in the first month that he had Passover, the 14th was the Sabbath. It was not the 15th. It was discounted right there at the beginning. Open for comment.
This is what has been passed around and is going to be seen more. And if we don't understand the Torah, the absolute base foundation from the Torah, this calendar is going to look pretty good, because it looks simple if you don't really think about it. So what are your comments now that we've gone through this?
You've got one in the chat by Henry Hamilton. He's got a question.
Henry, you got your question ready for us?
So if the Sabbath, those who follow the Sabbath from Friday evening to Saturday evening, is that based on the new moon calendar, and is it false?
Let me find a very good quote. I read it last night, and I would like to read it again. We have found that with the lunar calendar goes the sunset to sunset Sabbaths. So I'm going to read this quote. This is out of the book of Morgenstern, and he's talking very specifically about the calendar, about the time before Yahushua come onto the earth. I gotta find it. Okay, here it is. Let me get my spectacles. Yes. This is from the Hebrew Union College Annual, written in 1935. And this is his documentation. Now remember, this comes from the Judaism side. And so he is very, very proud of what he has found and documented. This is from history. He says here, summing up our conclusions thus far, it is clear that calendar 3 as a whole is the result of a gradual evolutionary process extending over a period of approximately 150 years from about 400 BC to about 250 BC, or even somewhat later than this. Speaking generally, the evolution of calendar 3 seems to have sprung out of the urge to develop, very interesting words here, to develop and adopt officially a perfect lunisolar calendar. It began accordingly with the transfer of the moments of celebrating Sukkot and the combined Passover Matzot festivals from their original dates to full moon days. Did you get that? They were transferred from the original dates to full moon days of the seventh and first months respectively, and of the New Year's Day from the 10th of the 7th month to the 1st of the 7th month. That's just a little adjustment that they made. The new moon day of the 7th month. So they had to adjust their calendar to accommodate these new moons that were adopted. This is the evolution of the calendar. It was completed only with the adoption of the new system of reckoning the day from evening to evening, with the consequent redating of the festivals, with each festival now beginning in the evening. I'm going to read that again. With each festival now beginning in the evening, with a new system of months of alternately 30 and 29 days each. Note, he declared that was a new system. That means there is a former different system. And continuing on, with each new Babylonian month names applied to them, and note this, with a new system of intercalation.
Yeah.
This is the quote coming from Morgenstern. Yes, the sunset to sunset Sabbaths had to evolve into the calendar along with the lunar system of worship.
So it evolved into an evening to evening. It didn't scripturally refer to an evening to evening. And there was something else that I don't believe that we mentioned this evening that was really evident about it being a counterfeit. Any calendar that has a 13th month, which we talked about in the beginning with Iraq and Yarko and all that, is a fraud. If it has 13 months, it's a fraud. And I'm not recalling right now, is it First Chronicles or Second Chronicles? I think it's 26, where Yahuwah put captains over each of the 12 a month. Yeah, over the 12 months. There's not a 13th month anywhere in scripture, although people can argue how Ezekiel, you know, laid on one side and laid on the other side, and that's something to do with the calendar. In reality, it has to do with redemption, and those numbers together equal the redemption shekel. So, we didn't mention that. I think that'd be an easy stop right there. Oh, 13th month, well, then obviously it's a fraud.
So that brings us to the tree of life in Revelation that had 12 fruits, one for each month. Does that mean on the 13th month there was no fruit for the nations?
No, the 13th month is the first month, right?
it's the first month, or is it the 13th month?
Well, there is no 13th month, so it would have to be the first month.
Yeah. So the tree of life only has 12 fruits, one for each month. There is no 13th month in Yahuwah's kingdom. It does not exist, period.
Yeah.
And with the lunar system of worship, the sunset to sunset Sabbaths are joined at the hip. They go one hand in hand together. Can two walk together lest they agree? And the sunset must go with the lunar system of worship. He records it, Morgan Stern records it as being adopted about 450 BC. The sunset Sabbath. So when you observe a sunset Sabbath, sunset to sunset, when the Sabbath is finished at sunset after the light season, what type of Sabbath was it that is written in Matthew 28:1 that finished at dawn? Matthew writes of 12 hours of Sabbath through the night. It finished at dawn. So if there's sunset to sunset Sabbaths finish at sunset, what type of Sabbath was Matthew writing about? Just Matthew, a question.
So Matthew was talking about 12-hour Sabbath?
No. Matthew was writing about a Sabbath that starts at dawn and ends at dawn. Dawn to dawn. That is exactly as how it's written in the scriptures in Genesis 1. The days start at dawn and they end at dawn. There's actually 36 times in the scriptures that the sunset failed to change the day of any kind. That's 36 times the sunset has failed. And I ask you, how many times does something have to fail before it becomes suspect?
Yeah.
Did Yahuwah make anything that failed? Anything? No. Yahuwah is the epitome of perfection, far more than we can comprehend. He will not make something that failed. The sunset does not change the day. When the everlasting covenant was given to Abraham, Abraham was in the daytime. The birds were flying. He sacrificed the animals, split them up, and he was chasing the birds away. Birds fly in the light season. They don't fly at night. It says, and then the sun had set when dark sleep had come over Abraham, and it was dark. And then the fiery furnace passed between the pieces, so that Abraham's portion was before the sunset. Yahuwah's portion was after the sunset. And yet the scriptures tell us that the covenant was in one day, one singular day. And at that time, Yahuwah was orchestrating the everlasting covenant. Is there any time that would be worse for the sun to fail, to change the day, than when Yahuwah was orchestrating the everlasting covenant?
Right.
And yet, the sunset failed to change the day on that time.
Yeah. Well, I agree with Charlene, who said that we've, you know, put a lot into this evening. It's getting kind of late, and that we're not going to get through it all. And I think it was fabulous how the Covenant Calendar Club members were able to do this. I love the way you put that together, Tim, giving them an opportunity to exercise what they've learned. And of course, we've learned most all of what we know. Most all of what we know at Covenant Calendar Club. So we're so grateful for Covenant Calendar Club, and so grateful that you give people an opportunity not just to speak and dictate to them, but to think for themselves using Scripture. So thank you guys very much. Wow. Good stuff. So, are we doing a part two next week? Or will we do
it? No. No, we're done with this. We'll go over this tomorrow morning with the Shabbat group. Whoever shows up, we'll go over it and see how they do. And Tim, I don't know, maybe we'll do part two of our covenant calendar journey on the 10th and the 11th. So that's kind of the plan right now, to do part two of that.
So the idea is you guys will do some more of this on Shabbat tomorrow. And then...
Yes.
And then, Tim, are you going to be able to, like, maybe record that into an MP4 and we can connect the two together as one, or would that be too long?
Connect to what we do tomorrow morning on this same calendar?
Yeah.
Sure, I can record that, no problem.
Okay. Y'all think it would be too long of a recording to post, or?
It will be pretty long, yes.
We'll make it into, like, two parts.
Yeah. Well, we'll basically be going over the pretty well what we did tonight. Won't we, Charlene?
Yeah. So we started right around 5:30, so we're at 2.5 hours. So Mario, we won't have time to do much more than that in the morning, because Shabbat Zoom follows us. So we'll be having to end whether we're done with the calendar or not.
Okay, so we have a plan. Well, someone want to close this out?
Can I say something really quick?
Absolutely. Go ahead, Josepha.
There's 70 Indian healing circle of rocks throughout North America. When they took these circle of rock formations and held it up to the skies, they actually mirrored the constellations in the sky. And they used it for their healing, And I just noticed in the previous thing, it was just kind of interesting. Also, I just want to say something really quickly. One of my Bible study, a lady that's in my Bible study in Calgary, had a scripture that was stuck on her Bible verse of the day, Obadiah number 1. After she shared it with me, it moved to the next one, and it was stuck on that for over a month, almost 2 months. And I felt it was meant for me to hear. And then I thought, well, maybe it's meant for more than just me to hear. So I'm not sure if there's something in Obadiah 1 that's particularly applicable to what's happening in the world today. But if somebody has any thoughts, if they could quickly share with me.
There's no quickly in this group.
You were quick about that, Mario.
we do have some hands up here. 6896 have his hand up. Is that you, Danan?
No, that's not me.
Okay.
I'm practicing being quiet.
Okay, whoever is 6896, unmute your phone. And,
well, that's Danan. He has to take his hand down.
Okay, then let's go to 8250. I believe that might be William. Are you there, William? I think that's you.
Yes, do you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you. Go ahead.
Oh, thank you. Hi. Shabbat Shalom. Wow. I was reading that there in regards to about 50 extra days. I never really noticed that before, but just quickly, it's just a little off the calendar there, but I'd like to share it. But it's about Yahuwah's giving his life for us at Passover and sacrificing himself for us. And for some reason, I was thinking, like, I always put it in my mind, just stamped it in my mind, that verse, Daniel 9:27, about all sacrifices shall come to a cease, and all sacrifices and oblations shall come to a cease in the midst of the week. And last year, Sabbath fell right in the midst, Passover fell right in the midst of the week. The following day was the first day of unleavened bread. And then the next day was preparation day. And then the following day was Sabbath. And for some reason, I was thinking today about Mary and I'm not sure who, how, there's a few different Marys there, but they went to go get spices for Yahushua's body. And they did this on the preparation day, and that was after the day of unleavened bread. And for some reason, I completely, all that was on my mind today was, okay, well, Mary and them went to go get spices for Yahushua's burial, so today's okay to go and to go get stuff that I needed for the home, right? Okay. Like food and propane. And so as I'm driving, this is what I'm thinking all the way I'm driving, and it totally slipped my mind about unleavened bread. And so then I get into town, and I'm on my way to pick up propane first, and Ava's trying to let me know, right? And I get a phone call from a friend, and she wishes me Shabbat Shalom, you know, and but I'm driving at the time, I quickly saw it, and I kept on driving, got to the propane place, and then I loaded up with propane, and then went to, then I pulled over and parked, I read a text message, and I was thinking, well, Mary and them, they bought spices on preparation day, because I was looking at today being preparation day, and for some reason, I'm stuck on the Passover being in the midst of the week, when Yahushua was crucified. So I go to Tim Hortons, I get a couple bagels there, and then I'm sitting here, and I'm listening, and I'm thinking, okay, well, that the fact sacrifices did come to a cease in the midst of the week at that time and period, for the way the Sabbath, the way the Passover fell on, the day it fell on. And I just took it, well, shouldn't the Passover always come on the same day of the way the seventh day Sabbath is? I was always looking, should the Sabbath, not Sabbath, the Passover fall on the same midst of the week like it did when Yahushua was crucified? And so I've just been feeling really lousy about going, oh, I wish I hadn't bought any propane, because he was already giving me a heads up to my friend. And so anyway, the second one I wish to share with is something he put on my mind, and that has to do with what was in Yahushua's cup when they were passing it around, when they were drinking it at the Last Supper. And there's a scripture, it's in Luke. I won't read it, but, well, I'll read part of it. But the angel said unto him, fear not, Zacharias, for thy prayer is heard, and thy wife Elizabeth shall bear thee a son, and thou shalt call it the name John. And thou shalt have joy and gladness, and many shall rejoice at his birth. For he shall be great in the sight of our Elohim, and shall drink neither wine nor strong drink. And that's always stuck in my mind about that. I wasn't sure where the scripture was, but Barbara showed me. But it was like, here's John, who is below Yahushua, and there was no wine or strong drink that touched his lips. And then there was another thought that came to my mind about where it had to do with a priest, or it's in 1 Timothy, where it says, if you could just give me one quick moment, I'm trying to find 1 Timothy, it's chapter 3, and it'd be nice to read it out of the Hallelujah Bible, because I'd like to hear what it says in that. I don't have one with me at the time here, but here we go, 1 Timothy, chapter 3, and it says the same thing. Was they speak of a bishop here, and that's why I'm curious, what do they say in the Hallelujah Bible? Because this is a true saying, if a man desires the office of a bishop, he desires a good work. A bishop then must be blameless, the husband of one wife, okay, vigilant, sober, of good behavior, given to hospitality, apt to teach, not given to wine, nor a striker, not greedy or filthy looser, but patient, not a brawler, not covetousness. But there was that wine again. And I'm just thinking, like, John didn't take any wine. He never touched his lips. The same thing with being a teacher. Basically, that's what I'm kind of looking at in a sense. No wine touching their lips and being very holy. And I'm thinking Messiah, he is one above all. Like, and when he refused the vinegar on when he was up on the cross there, I'm thinking, well, he didn't want any, like wine has gone bad. It's a grape that's gone bad, and alcohol is another thing that's gone bad. And vinegar is kind of similar to that. So I was thinking, not saying, it's always been on my mind that there was never wine in the cup. I don't know what the liquid was. The thought, one time I was sharing this with a pastor in church in regards to what the liquid was in the cup. Like, Yahushua never said what the liquid was. He always said, if you drink from this cup, and it was the way we live our lives in condition to the way he lived his life. But so the pastor shared back to me, he goes, what, was it water? And you know, I don't know, maybe it was water, because he always spoke about living water. So I don't know, it's not the liquid what's important, it's the cup, the metaphor of what he was speaking about with the cup. But I don't believe any wine touched his lips, just as John, no wine touched his lips. It's just a thought. Just something was on my mind, and I'm so sorry, and I'm so sorry to Abba, Yahuwah, for he's trying to open my eyes up, you know. Like, just before I got there, she texts me. I'm driving like I'm a block away, you know, just to let me know, like, Shabbat Shalom. I never clicked. Maybe it's that pride thing, you know. It's I was put on my mind, you know, let not pride cover wisdom. And I don't think of pride of myself, but I was thinking, the lady, you know, when they went to go get spices on preparation day. And so anyway, I'm sorry, but that's just stuff that was on my mind. It's just nice to share with fans who love Abba and love Yahuwah and Yahusha. And so Shabbat Shalom. Thank you, William.
Thank you, William. We appreciate your input. We appreciate it.
You're welcome.
We have some other hands up here. We got to get through this kind of quickly. We need to shut down.
Yeah, okay.
So go ahead, Jose.
Yeah, I'll make it quick. On that note, I just wanted to thank you, you know, you and Charlene, both Tim and Charlene and Mario for hosting, you know, a wonderful Peshach for those who could not make it, you know, and so we glued together, you know, in one body. Loving each other enough to do that. And so much appreciate all of you that took your time to prepare a wonderful Peshach for everyone. And another thing I just wanted to, just really quick, you know, one of the things, the fruits of the Spirit, what I'm seeing from this teaching and from this ministry is that it is a ministry based on the love of Yahusha. And I'm understanding that, because that is helping me discern those who are false witnesses and those who are true witnesses. You know, the more you love the Father and the Son, the more I know you're going to speak the truth into my life. And this is why this ministry, you know, really converts me to become even a stronger believer. I grow in my spiritual understanding and my and knowledge in all things. And so I wanted to thank you, all of you, for that. And one other thing is that, you know, I think we've heard this many times, but for as long as we understand that the teachings that we receive are based on Scripture, we have the foundation of the truth to guard us, and we're able to defend our position with Scripture based on the teachings that we're listening to in this platform. So it's wonderful. I just want to thank all of you. And yeah, your light shines so bright because you love Yahushua so much. And that allows us to really, really know that the fruits that we're receiving are from the true vine, from the true tree of life, you know, and not from the tree of knowledge and evil, but the true of life. the tree of life, sorry, tree of life. Thank you all for that.
Baruch Hashem Yahuwah. Baruch Hashem Yahuwah. Yeah, Yah be all the glory, all the praise.
Yeah. And amen, brother.
I have one question.
He's put together and put together and put together, and here we are. So,
And Henry Hamilton, you have another question?
Yeah. Yesterday there was a gathering for
myself. I can't stay. I'm sorry. I'm at a threshold where I need to go. But we're leaving it playing. So, go ahead and ask your question, Henry. And there's like six more hands that are up. And each time it comes down, another three hands go up.
Okay.
Okay. We need to close this down. So Henry, your question will be the last one, and then we're going to need someone to volunteer prayer to close this down. So if somebody can think about volunteering for prayer, we'd appreciate it. Go ahead, Henry. What's your question?
So the Passover, there was a Passover gathering yesterday, and I thought, and I'm confused to why their Passover gathering was yesterday when I see Passover being said that it's next week on just other platforms on your media.
That's because they do not go by the blood ratified covenant that has its foundation based between Genesis 1 and Exodus 24:11. They do not understand that Yahusha lived out the blood ratified covenant in his life and his death. They do not go by that. They do not acknowledge it. And there's many other calendars out there that are derived from the desires of man that are manipulated and twisted and turned and have no scriptural base whatsoever. This calendar that we're observing today, right now, has everything it speaks of, everything that it does, everything that it reveals is fully based on the Torah without any exception. It does not break any statutes whatsoever in any way, shape, or form. It does not ignore them. It does not slight them. It is totally based on the Hebrew words and definitions. Precisely exactly what is written in the scriptures. Everything has been applied to charts back and forward. It's been taken from the events that happen in the scriptures, and it's been proven solidly 100%. That's what? Why we're here today on this feast today.
Oh. So the blood ratified covenant, what?
Blood ratified covenant calendar. When we went over it just a little bit earlier, when the Hebrew nation agreed to the everlasting covenant three times at Mount Sinai, and then it was blood ratified by Moshe, that calendar had been laid down with precision that is absolutely astounding in the Exodus from Egypt to Mount Sinai. Now, that's not the only example. That is just one of them. But the precision laid down in that Exodus, it will astoundingly reveal the calendar. And I invite you to go over that with us. If you need to do that personally on a Zoom, I would be very willing to do that.
Okay.
Or we can go to studythecalendar.com, and it is on the website. Exodus, what's the name of it, Charlene? Exodus from Egypt to Pentecost at Sinai?
It's the very first study in the 2018 series, but if I can just make a very quick comment, Henry. We go by the equinox shadow, okay, that is the last day of the year, and the next day is the first day of the year, which this year, I think, was March the 20th. So that was the first day. That's why we got to the 14th. For Passover yesterday. So it's all about starting the year that way instead of with the moon. I don't know. I think that's really what he wanted to know. How did we get to Passover yesterday? Yeah. So,
okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Do we have any volunteers for prayer?
I think it was Eric that was nominated to do closing prayer, if he's still willing.
I'm quite sure it was.
I'm quite sure he's willing.
This has been great. I'm going to really sleep tonight. Okay. Abba Yahweh, we just give you all praise and thanks for everything. Thank you for everybody who participated tonight and for everybody who had their ears open, revelation into their lives tonight. And we thank you, Father, that we glean more and more every time we get into your scriptures and every time we fall back on the teachings we have been given by Tim and Charlene and Mario and T4. And we're just so excited to have a group like this together that would come under and just praise you and give you all the glory, you and your son, Yahushua HaMashiach. For none of this would be possible if it wasn't for both of you to lay all this out for us, to redeem us, to love us, and give us the opportunity to have eternal life with you. And we just love you, and we thank you, and we give you all the glory and praise in the name of Yahushua HaMashiach, after the order of Melchizedek, whom we love, serve, who is the first fruits in the wave sheaf offering. Thank you, Abba. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, everyone.
Yes, thank you. You were great tonight. Everybody was great.